William Morrow and Harper Audio present Pink Glass Houses, a novel by Asha Elias. Performed by Stacy Gonzalez, Saskia Maarleveld, Andi Arndt, Helen Laser, André Santana, Amy Landon, John Pirhalla, Robin Miles, Michael Crouch, and Jane Oppenheimer. For India and JJ.
From Gabriela Machado, May 13th, 2019, to All Sunset Academy. Subject: A message from the Sunset Academy PTA president. Dear parents, I'm writing to you as a follow-up to Principal Ileana Garcia's email. I assume you are all aware of this morning's tragic event that occurred at our neighboring school, Miami Beach Middle. We are enormously relieved that none of our precious children were harmed. The Sunset Academy PTA wants you all to know that our thoughts and prayers are with the family of the deceased and with our entire community, as we are all grieving. I also want to assure you that both schools went on lockdown before the tragedy would have been visible to any students who happened to be outside. The Miami Beach Police Department arrived on the scene moments after the incident and were quick and discreet in roping off the area. I've spoken with Principal Garcia, and our administration has arranged for grief counselors to be available to all students and faculty beginning tomorrow morning. It has been a dark day for our community, but together we will get through this. In the meantime, we encourage you to speak with your children about what happened in an age-appropriate manner. We are working with the school administration, law enforcement, and several mental health professionals to come up with a toolkit for each of you to have meaningful family discussions. Some of those resources are already available in our shared Dropbox, which can be accessed here. Grief Toolkit_Sunset Academy. Please do not hesitate to reach out to me with any questions. Be safe, be well, and go Sunset Seagulls. All my best, Gabriela. Gabriela Machado, Sunset Academy PTA President.
Charlotte. 10 months earlier. There are three types of moms at Sunset Academy. The know-nothings, the think-they-knows, and the ones who get shit done. Me? I'm one of the rare birds that make up the latter. I mean, some of these moms don't even know their kid's teacher's name. Can you imagine? Try hitting up that kind with a contribution for the holiday gift. Scratching my damn head. I mean, here we are at the best public elementary school in Florida, and these empty brains can't even pick their child's classroom out on a school map. How do you think Sunset became number one? I'll tell you how. It's because we have the most active fundraising machine of a PTA east of the Mississippi. But if I'm being honest, the dum-dums aren't even the biggest problem. It's those god-awful think-they-knows. The, oh, I'd love to be co-room mom with you, Charlotte, and then can't even design and fabricate a fucking door decoration ones. I know I sound triggered right now, but you wouldn't believe the flack I get from some of these moms. And after all the work I put into this place. But they still act like just because my work isn't in an office, it must be easy. Excuse me if I don't have a W-2. And by the way, a job isn't an excuse for not being active in your children's lives. Just saying. I'm excited to see what this school year has in store for us, though. I have plans, plans, plans. Taking Sunset to the next level and all that. It's my last year as VP of fundraising, and there's a lot of pressure on me to keep outdoing myself. Things are great, as I said, but there is always room for improvement. If no one gets in my way, I predict another record breaker. Miami is competitive, like New York competitive, but less angry and more tan. Trade black tailoring for brightly colored miniskirts and you get the idea. So I started planning Sunset Academy's fundraising initiatives for this school year back in June. Everyone else was hopping into the D terminal at Miami International and boarding a plane to Mallorca or Capri. And I was posted up at Panther Coffee with a cold brew, my laptop, and a prospect list. Donors are hit up relentlessly from September to December. But if you catch them early enough, before the vultures start picking at the carcasses of those family foundations and grants, you can pull in so much more cash. I wouldn't say that fundraising is my calling. My calling is motherhood. But I'm good at raising money, and it gives me a platform to help with my children's education. And it's not like my family has the time to just flit away for 6 weeks anyway. My husband, James, has always said,
"Babe, all these people spending the whole summer away, they aren't focused on daily market volatility."
To which I say, "Fine with me. I have work to do too." He always rolls his eyes at me when I call fundraising work. And isn't that just typical for a finance guy? If it doesn't inflate your own bank account, it must not be a worthy use of time. But at least we are on the same page about getting a late start to summer vacation. The kids went to day camp for the first few weeks, and James got all those extra days in the office. A good investment banker doesn't come with a pause button, but that's probably why I married him. Well, that and because he Miami Viced me on our first date way back when. You know that move? It's when you're driving over the causeway in a convertible, and as you pass over the sparkling Biscayne Bay, the guy puts the top down and starts blasting Phil Collins's In the Air Tonight. James had game. So, to kick off the summer, I closed as many deals as possible. "Hello, Walker Family Foundation. Check your grant request." And then we peaced out on Miami until the beginning of August. A small sacrifice in service to a school that is a true gem in the community. We spent 3 weeks traveling in Sardinia and Capri, sunning ourselves along the rocky beaches and eating the most incredible fresh pastas. Little Madeline got so bronzed that we all started calling her Golden Girl. And isn't that just fitting? Even Axel soaked up the Italian lifestyle, which is saying a lot. You know how these adolescent boys can be, and he really nails the moody, hormonal thing. I was actually so proud. He added a little color to his pastiness. That's what happens when you don't have PlayStation at the hotel. And he loved, I mean loved, the food. He clearly shares my enthusiasm for a good meal, though I rarely let myself indulge. But it's all so good and clean there, and Axe and I would both literally lick our pasta bowls clean after every dinner, much to the disgust of Maddie and my husband. Even James relaxed a bit. He worked for only like 3 to 4 hours per day. It was the perfect family vacation. By the time we touched back down at MIA, my inbox was exploding with requests. Every family at Sunset wanted me to plan an event for their super cool local business in return for a meager percentage of sales back to the school. No thanks. I'm raising money for Sunset Academy, not your family's pizza restaurant. But also my girlfriend slash PTA president, Gabriella, was begging for my back-to-school PowerPoint slides. Back-to-school night is like the social kickoff to the school year, when all the students and parents get together to hear about bell schedules and fundraisers and dress codes and all that. So that was on deck in a couple of weeks, and I had to be ready to present. It's not easy to step on stage in front of 1,000 Miami Beach families and deliver my spiel for the year, especially when some of those families, and I mean a small minority, and I mean clearly the losers, are absolute haters. I could raise $1 billion and have Bill Gates himself give a kindergarten commencement speech, and some people would still be all, "But you used plastic cups at the post-Bill Gates commencement reception, and don't you know how bad that is?" I know. Why on earth would I slog away for no money and deal with all this whining from the peanut gallery? Well, what wouldn't I do for Madeline Rose? My sugar and spice, cooler than ice, perfection in motion, little Maddie. She's my forever why. If that girl asked me to hang the moon over her four-poster bed, I'd call Elon Musk and say, "Get me on the next SpaceX mission pronto." In the meantime, I'm content to bust my butt for her school with my fundraising initiatives as their gala chair, safety council founding member, and, room mom of the year. My events have raised 300% more than what my predecessors scrounged together. And that, my friends, is how you give your daughter the best education in the U.S. of A. My efforts alone have resulted in resurfacing the entire basketball court, installing a state-of-the-art STEM lab, a daily organic salad bar in the cafeteria, cutting-edge online reading and math supplements, and completely new instruments for the music room. And now that my little angel is going into the third grade, you better believe I'm kicking things up a notch. This is the year of statewide standardized tests. We need to be up on our P's and Q's. Test scores equal funding. Funding supports our reputation. Our reputation gets us into the best middle school. The right middle school feeds into the most competitive high schools. And before you know it, boom, Harvard. You think I'm joking, but this is very serious. Nothing is guaranteed, of course, but future success in children is dependent on taking early action and following a bulletproof plan toward advancement. I wish my parents would have been this methodical with my own education. Sure, I was studious and hardworking and kept a breakneck extracurricular schedule, but there was no strategy to it all. The Ivies are looking for excellence these days, not some no-name B-rated school salutatorian from the burbs with a JV cheer career. Public schools, the right public schools to be exact, are very in favor right now. Yes, by high school, you really need to be in an elite private. But first, it's preferable to come up with the masses, the right masses. And that's why we're at Sunset. Just this morning, Maddie told me, "Mommy, you're the MVP of this school and everyone knows it. You should run for president." And you know what? She's right. Why am I slogging away making everything happen for this place when the PTA president gets all the glory? I mean, I'm doing all this work for the benefit of the kids, but come on, even Mother Teresa got to be on the covers of magazines. They made her a saint, for Christ's sake. And I'm not going to wait until I'm dead to get what I'm due. I told James, I think I'm going to run to be PTA president next year. It's a 2-year position, and after that, Maddie will be in middle school. We need to leave Sunset with a bang. He said,
that job is a sucker's bet. Why are you going to work like a whipped dog for no pay? And who is going to manage things here at home while you're off being the Sunset Academy Mother Teresa?
Major eye roll, I know. I said, the housekeeper, obviously. And don't you want me to make a difference in our daughter's school for her education? But he was already back to checking his email at that point, and I swear, I could run, win, and serve as PTA president, and he would not even notice.
Melody. We were in the wrong place. We had to be. We pulled into the Sunset Academy parking lot for back-to-school night, and I double-checked the address on Google Maps. I mean, it was the same building where we had registered Lucy just days earlier. The school name was affixed to the entrance. But this wasn't an elementary school event. It just couldn't have been. Stepping out of the rows of fancy cars were the oddest families I'd ever seen. Moms were wearing denim cutoffs, short denim cutoffs, like their butts were hanging out. Daisy Dukes, we used to call them. These were paired with high heels and pussy bow blouses. The dads were in loud button-up shirts and used an alarming amount of hair gel. The small children kept walking into people because they, and everyone, had their faces glued to their cell phones. I bit my tongue, but gave Greg some major side eye. Couldn't he have gotten a promotion to relocate literally anywhere else? It was all wildly confusing, but back to school night was our introduction to Lucy's new school, and a swan dive, as it turned out, into Miami culture. The shock was immediate. It seemed like we'd slipped into a parallel universe where moms dressed and talked like teenagers, and elementary school kids also dressed and talked like teenagers, and everyone drove Maseratis and Porsches and had professional hair and makeup done for an event that takes place at 5 p.m. on a Monday. And this is at a public elementary school. Miami Beach is definitely not Wichita. Weeks earlier, we had found our new home, a charming 1930s Art Deco house painted cotton candy pink. It was located in Miami Beach's Pine Tree neighborhood, which several of Greg's coworkers had told us was perfect for families. With its cozy two bedrooms, the new place was much smaller than our Wichita home, but it had won us over right away with the tidy pair of sable palm trees that flanked the front door and the pièce de résistance, an oblong backyard pool. On moving day, Lucy ditched Greg and me with the moving van and dove into the deep end, fully clothed, staying in the water until well after the boxes had been unloaded. The pine tree house, adorable and homey as it was, also came with a rent that made our Wichita mortgage look like a grocery bill. We were used to sprawling lots of land and grand homes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.